So I think I'm going to start. So we are very happy to have Professor Trevor Wooley visiting today. Professor Wooley got his PhD within 2 years of his PhD in 1990 from the University of London under the supervision of Obama. He then spent 1 year at IAS and was a professor at the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor from 1991 to 2007. He then moved to University of Bristol in 2007. He was a Sloan Fellow from 1993 to 1995, and he obtained the Sloan Prize in 1998 for his significant breakthrough on Waring¹s problem. He was elected a Fellow of the Royal Society in 2007, and is a Fellow of the Fellow of Animation in 2012. He was an invited IBM speaker in 2002 for his first breakthrough on Waring¹s problem. And in 2012, he made an even bigger breakthrough on Waring¹s problem and was given another IBM talk in 2014. He will talk to us today on the translation-invariant perspective on arithmetic and harmonic analysis.
Okay, well, thank you for the sparkling introduction and for hosting me here at Waterloo. It's a return visit for me. I don't think these things are on the wall the last time I came, but they're very, very interesting looking. So what I want to do is to give some kind of insights, some ideas about what's going on with ideas which have led to a kind of a breakthrough in our understanding of exponential sums, and that also intersects with some work in harmonic analysis these days, this decoupling work of Bourgain, Demeter, and Guth. But this is a colloquium, and I always used to fail my colloquium tests, so you should begin with something everybody can understand. So, in the beginning, there was one, two, and three. I was going to say, if there are logicians in the audience, maybe I'm still on unsafe ground, but I'm assuming that people know what one, two, and three are. Yeah. Okay, so observe, this is deep mathematics here, but one, two, and three satisfy a very special relationship, right? So the average of one and three is two, is the middle guy. So one, two, and three satisfy this equation, x minus 2y plus z equals zero. They are a three-term arithmetic progression, which means that several things. So one thing is I can still obtain a solution of that same equation if I put a zero on the end of everything. Which means multiplying by the same thing, not necessarily 10, of course, because I didn't tell you what base I'm using here, but okay, so that actually shows that I could multiply by any non-zero integer and it would still work, right? Good, okay, so we still got a solution. That's dilation invariance. And I could also add the same number to everything that I've seen before. So I added 7 in this case, and you can see that 17, 27, and 37 are still solutions of this same equation, x minus 2y plus z equals zero. So that's the translation invariance. I translated all the numbers by the same fixed quantity. Good, okay, that's a three-term arithmetic progression. We started with something simple. So I can sort of just encode that all a bit more rapidly with this statement here, but if I take an initial solution, x0, y0, z0, multiply them all by a fixed integer d, and add a fixed quantity a, that's still a solution. And if d was non-zero, then I can even reverse course with that transformation. Good, so this is not new, this kind of thing, you'll be surprised to know. Okay, now the same is true for lots of other equations. So here's another linear equation where the same thing is true. And the reason why this is still, well, it's still dilation invariant because, of course, it's homogeneous, but it's even translation invariant because the sum of the coefficients is zero. That's all I needed. So that's very simple. And I don't have to sit with just one equation. I could have systems of equations. So the top system, a pair of simultaneous equations, encodes four-term arithmetic progressions. X, Y, Z, W are a four-term arithmetic progression if they satisfy that pair. And I could take a whole system of such equations, and that equation one, system of equations one, gives me an R plus 2 term arithmetic progression. So this, just to connect with less trivial mathematics, is all very much connected with work of Klaus Roth more than half a century ago, Zamoedi and Gowers on the Erdős-Turán conjecture. So just to spend a couple of seconds on this for a moment. So if you suppose that you have a subset of the natural numbers, and you ask that this subset contains a non-trivial non-trivial arithmetic progression, for example, maybe you ask that it solves this system one, where you want to avoid having trivial solutions. So it's obvious that if I set all of these variables to be exactly the same, then that's automatically a solution because I arranged that the sum of the coefficients was zero. So I'm looking for interesting solutions that are not of this trivial type. And the sort of thing that that Roth and subsequent workers have proved is that as long as your set has a number of elements up to n, which is pretty close to n, it's smaller than n, in fact it has zero density as n goes to infinity, but it's still pretty close to n, then you're guaranteed to get solutions of this system of equations. I haven't exactly explained the parameters here, but this is true for this system one, for example. And what Roth proved, actually, was if you have a system of R equations of this general type, and the number of variables is more than twice the number of equations, then you get such a conclusion.
What is this A, S?
So all I mean here is that I've got an S tuple of entries from the set A. Who was asking that question? Sorry, my eyesight's really bad. Yeah, good. I told you my eyesight was really bad. Yeah, so I'm just looking at an S tuple of integers. For example, I might take an R plus 2 tuple of elements from this set A, and I want to avoid those trivial solutions, but I'm guaranteed to get a non-trivial R plus 2 arithmetic progression of length R plus 2 from the set A if my set has density which is growing more rapidly than n over a power of log log n. In fact, the latest word on this, if you have three-term arithmetic progressions, you can do slightly better than log n. So if you have a set which has a number of elements growing more rapidly than n over log n to the 1 plus a very small positive quantity, then that's guaranteed to contain three-term arithmetic progressions. That's a very recent result of Thomas Bloom and Olaf Sysask, which has yet to enter print. And that means that automatically you contain non-trivial free-term progressions in primes, or dense subsets of the primes for free. Okay, so that was not as trivial as the first slide. It wasn't supposed to be. So that's just to give you a clue that these translation, dilation, invariant linear systems of equations are things which are much studied in the additive combinatorics community. And I'll just give you a very brief, so I don't mean to labor this, but just a very brief idea of a proof to see where the connection lies. So the idea is that if we look at a three-term progression, for example, I suppose that my set A has delta times n elements up to capital N, n is supposed to be a big number here. And there are two sort of alternatives in this game. Either the set is really randomly behaved in every sense that could be true. So every short interval contains roughly the right number of elements. Every arithmetic progression modulo q contains roughly the right number of elements. And then you can use some harmonic analysis to show that the number of solutions altogether grows something like a cubed over n, the cardinality of a cubed divided by n, which is growing rather rapidly, more rapidly than the number of trivial solutions. And in the contrary case, again, using some harmonic analysis, it's either a variant of the Hardy-Littlewood method or something similar, which I really don't want to go into the details of that argument right here. But you get a conclusion which shows that if you fail to have such random behavior, quasi-random behavior, then in fact there's a particular arithmetic progression A modulo Q within the set A which contains very slightly more elements in a relative sense than the whole set that you started off with. And so you've got a density increment. You've sort of increased the density of the set in this subprogression. And because we're in a translation-dilation invariant world, I can shift all of the elements of my set by the same A, where I've got that overabundance of solutions. Now all what I have are multiples of Q, so I can divide by Q, and I've got a whole new set of elements looking pretty much like the original set, which is slightly denser, although in a shorter interval. And then I can repeat this process, and if I iterate enough times, and I've got enough room to iterate, then eventually I find that I'm in a set which has density as close as I like to one. So in other words, like all the integers, and it's easy to find an arithmetic progression there. And when you reverse course, you find an arithmetic progression in the original set that you started with. So notice that the translation and dilation invariants played a critical role in that argument. Good, okay, so, but we're not interested in boring linear equations. Linear equations can be good, of course, but we want to be nonlinear. So here's a nonlinear system of equations. So it's a pair of quadratic and a linear equation. They all have the same coefficients in that example. And you can see this by pure thought, but I'm here to entertain you. So you can just apply the binomial theorem here, right, to see that this is also translation-dilation invariant. So it's certainly translation invariant. If I shift all my variables by the same quantity, apply the binomial theorem, then in the quadratic, I get the original quadratic back again, plus a multiple of the linear equation. And so if both of these equations are satisfied, this whole thing is going to be zero. And the linear equation is even easier to see that. So certainly translation invariant, and it's homogeneous as well, so it's dilation invariant. Good, so that's a more complicated example. And that's a part of a general theme. So here's another apparently more general-looking example. Here I have coefficients now, C1 up to CT, and equations of degree 1 up to K, lots of equations. And this is translation-dilation invariant as long as the sum of the coefficients are zero. So you can see now we've got a whole zoo of examples to look at, which means we can have some more fun. So this is the kind of thing which I have in mind for this talk. And I want to stress that although you may have looked at the previous example and thought, well, this is all very dull because it's a very special type of system and maybe what I'm interested in isn't really of that type, you can look at functions which are not purely of this nice pure power type. You know, there I had powers from sort of x squared up to x to the k. You could imagine more general functions, and you can approximate them under appropriate circumstances by objects or systems which are of the type which we just looked at. So, I mean, of course, if I have a suitably smooth function, then you can imagine using Taylor's theorem, for example, to approximate this by a polynomial, and maybe you can hope to get a good error term here. If you're a conventional analyst, you probably just think of the real expansion here. You could also think of this as a p-adic expansion if you're a number theorist. So then what goes into this error term here might be small if it's divisible by a large power of your favorite prime p. So then you could still be looking at a polynomial with stuff which is divisible by big powers of p, and that still has this property. And then if you have a sort of a sum of differences of this which is small, you might be able to relate it to these sums of powers systems once again. So that's supposed to convey that this is more general than it might look at first glance. Okay, so I want to say a few words about exponential sums now. And this is really the starting point for a lot of analytic number theory going back to the 1920s and 1930s even, with work of I.M. Vinogradov. And so the idea is that we start with our favorite function, capital F, which might not be a polynomial, but maybe it has appropriate smoothness properties. And we're interested in sums of e to the 2 pi I, so maybe Fourier series associated with
some problem. And just as notation, in case you haven't met it, I'll write E of Z of E to the 2 pi IZ. That's how you know you're talking with a professional analytic number theorist. So you can impress your friends if you're not one or whatever. So just to show that, you know, this sort of thing is something which really crops up in the real world. Okay, who am I kidding? Not the real world. In the real analytic number theory world. So if I were thinking about the Riemann zeta function, one way to look at this, if you're interested in understanding how rapidly this grows, an interesting place for this kind of problem is on the half line, where the real part of S is a half. So then you use the approximate functional equation, and you approximate it in terms of partial sums of n to the minus it. This is the relevant part, so the sum weight, which may come from the real part here. And so you should think of t as being large, and then the game is to replace the n to the minus it by e to the 2 pi I times something, and that something is going to be a function which is logarithmic in the summand, in this way. So you get sort of an x over n here. And then if you just do the obvious thing, expand by Taylor series, which I've sort of have some words about here in a more general context, then you can imagine, can't you, that if I choose enough coefficients, a big enough degree polynomial, then maybe I really get a good approximation and I can try to understand that exponential sum, the partial sum of Riemann zeta function, by understanding these sums. And that's what Vinogradov did in the 1930s, 1937. And this method was refined up until the end of the 50s. And actually, if you're interested in the zero free region for the Riemann zeta function, that's still the best kind of approach that we have today. That's Vinogradov. Yes, good, a formidable character. So what did Vinogradov do? He realized that when you look at these exponential sums, one way to estimate them pointwise is by getting estimates for the mean values of these exponential sums. So this object is periodic modulo 1 with respect to alpha 1 up to alpha k. Right, remember, there's a hidden 2 pi I lurking around here. So if I change the argument, this is an integer, change the argument by 2 pi, by 1 rather, that's like a multiple of 2 pi in the ordinary exponential function, it's periodic. So the right thing to do is to integrate over the k-dimensional unit cube. And let's just think about that for a little bit, because there's a number theoretic interpretation of this. So the idea is to use orthogonality. So this exponential sum has the nice property that its conjugate is just the same thing with the argument switched in sign. And then if I expand this, it's kind of a big mess, but it's a sum over 2s summands altogether, x1 up to xs and y1 up to ys. And if I expand all the polynomial stuff, I get a linear combination of expressions which look pretty much like those translation-invariant equations which I saw earlier. And of course, I'm integrating over these alphas, so orthogonality comes into play. And I get a contribution here. I get a zero contribution if any one of these terms is non-zero. And I get a contribution of 1 anytime all of them vanish simultaneously. If they all vanish, then I'm looking at E of 0. That's just known as 1. And if I integrate 1 over unit cube, I get back 1. So I'm just counting precisely the number of solutions of this system of diagonal equations when I look at variables in a box of size x. Think of x as being a very big positive number. So there we are again. And it's a translation-dilation-invariant system of equations, which means that we have some tools available for creating structure which otherwise would be absent. Okay, so what I'm going to do next is just to talk a little about the kind of estimates that you can get for this integral. And then I'll talk about some applications. So if you feel like you're losing the will to live in a few minutes, there'll be something very tangible which crops up just in a moment. And then I'll talk about a few more applications, try to give you a hint about what's going on in the underlying method here. Okay, so estimates for this object go by the name of Vinogradov's mean value theorem, which I'll come back to in a moment. I don't think there's controversy about calling it this, but the recent literature has been all over the place. Okay, so first of all, what should we expect for the number of solutions here? So there are some obvious solutions. If I set xi equal to yi for every I, you don't get a prize for realizing that that's a solution. So there are at least x to the s solutions. And even I can make more solutions if I permute the xi's relative to the yi's. But we won't worry about that here. Okay, so what else? So there are various ways of finding other lower bounds. So there's a method which is more elementary than what I described, but I think it's less easy to see the bound just at a glance. So another idea is to look at a really small neighborhood of the alphas. So I'm going to make the alpha j's at most a small constant times x to the minus j. And if you think about the arguments of these exponential sums, I've got a polynomial, and each alpha j is so small that the total contribution, when I add together all of these things, is at most 1 over 100, say. I have really set it up so that's even true. And now I'm looking at the exponential of this e to the 2 pi I times something which is at most 1 over 100. So, you know, this cos of something plus sine of something else, it's really close to 1. Doesn't matter how I look at it. So when I add together over all the summands, what I get is something which is really close to x. And if I integrate that 2s moment of this exponential over this particular very small box, I get something which is like x to the 2s times some constant, times the measure of the box. And the measure of the box, you can see it's visibly basically the product of these x to the minus j's, x to the minus a half k, k plus 1. And so I've got a lower bound, which looks like x to the 2s minus a half k, k plus 1, which, by the way, is the sum of the degrees in the problem. And if you count points on rational points on varieties, that's kind of an expected outcome. So that's a sort of a pure thought way of understanding this lower bound for more elementary methods which take a little more to describe. Okay, so whatever lower bound we get for JSK of X, we've got two possibilities, and so up to a constant factor, what you see at the top of the slide is a lower bound. And in analytic number theory, a well-known principle is that if you can't think of anything better to do, your conjecture is just to assert that the lower bound, which you can actually prove, is actually the upper bound, and maybe you put in an x to the epsilon for safety, where epsilon is supposed to be some positive number. Good, okay, so we did that. That is the main conjecture in the subject. Good, okay. Right, so the classical situation, and really this was the story up until about 2010, something like this. There's a method which gives you an upper bound which has a similar sort of flavor to this, if S is big. I haven't let you digest this, but there's a sort of a term which looks very much like the second of these terms in the conjecture with an extra quantity which at least is decaying exponentially as S gets large. So if S is, I don't know, k squared log k, maybe times a constant, this object here is 1 over some power of k. It's really pretty small. It's not epsilon for any epsilon positive, but it's rather small. So this is a reasonable approximation to the conjecture if S has size which is a constant k squared log k. And the only difference between 1949 or so and 2010 was in the 90s, there was a refinement of this method, which actually I came up with in my thesis, which improves this by a factor 2 in the exponent. So that's actually significant. It means you've got twice as rapid exponential decay. And I was very proud at the time. But pride wears off with time. I never should have been proud in the first place, of course. But anyway, so, and one observation is that you can sort of bootstrap these ideas to get pointwise bounds for these exponential sums. And then you can use that to actually obtain an asymptotic formula even for this mean value. And that asymptotic formula, well, classically became effective with about 3k squared log k variables. Maybe I say this on the next slide. So, yeah, so if you just remember the main conjecture, there are sort of two regimes of interest. So one is where s is smaller than a half k plus 1, the sum of the degrees in the system of equations, and the other is for more variables than this. And what this discussion I just had was that classically, you could establish the second sort of estimate if s was larger than a half k plus 1 by a factor, a constant times log k. So when k is big, it's log k is not so big, but it's definitely going to infinity as k goes to infinity. And people worked very hard on special cases, so you could actually prove the whole of the main conjecture for k equals 1, which you don't get a prize for, and k equals 2. And for larger k, you could get this diagonal regime for s going up to about k instead of a half k squared. You can get asymptotic formulae, and you know, you could improve by a constant factor some of these upper bounds. So that's the classical story. And the big news from the last couple of years is that the main conjecture is now a theorem for all s. That's good, right? So you really get exactly the bounds which I was mentioning. And this has come through two methods which superficially can look very different. So one is all about congruences, which is the viewpoint I'm going to describe. And the other is all about short intervals, the so-called decoupling method of Bourgain, Demeter, and Guth. And in reality, there are two different perspectives on the same method. So if you're a number theorist, hopefully you realize that a short interval of real numbers is very much analogous to a congruence class. So one is a p-adic short interval, the other is a real short interval. And so when you dig inside these methods, you can see that there's a fundamental commonality which is right at the heart of both methods. So they're really both the same methods. And so previously I'd sort of established the cubic case of this main conjecture, and even most of the critical interval using this efficient congruencing method, and Bourgain, Demeter, and Guth covered the last one-third k here. And it has to be said, I mean, sort of taking some inspiration from one aspect of their method, you can modify the efficient congruencing method to get rid of this one-third k as well. So, there are simplifications to both methods which come out of this circle of ideas. Good, okay, there was one thing here. So there's still work to do. So presumably, epsilon should be zero if k is 3 or more. That's really should be the case, and we don't know that. For k equals 2, there's definitely a logarithmic factor when s is 3, when s is a half times 2 times 3. Good. So, So I mentioned approximate translation dilation invariance. So here's a system which is approximately translation dilation invariant. So you can choose your favorite polynomials. They might be x squared up to x to the k. That's one possible example. But you could choose other polynomials, maybe of degree much bigger than k. And as long as the Wronskian of that system of polynomials is non-zero, then you get an upper bound for the corresponding mean value, which is diagonal all the way up to a half of k times k plus 1. So that's a much more general statement of what's embodied in the Wiener-Gradov mean value theorem. And the same kind of idea. So different ways of looking at this. You can either approximate these polynomials p-adically and obtain an approximation to this translation-dilation invariant system, which I mentioned before, or you can approximate them by short real intervals. It's the same story. Okay. I can see that some people are losing the will to live, so let's have something very tangible. Right, so this is one of my favorite topics for amusement. Is it too much to hope for any undergraduates here? Anybody confess to being an undergraduate? Yes, okay, we may have some undergraduates who don't want to confess, right. So this is a potential, you can do research on this and actually gain fame and glory. Right, so here's a system. This is translation-dilation invariant. We know that, don't we? Because we've seen this before. And this time, I've got k equations and sort of k plus one variables on each side of these equations. And I know, because we thought about this, you know as well, that if I just permute the variables on one side to get the variables on the other, that's definitely a solution. That's boring, right? That's no prizes for that. So can we find a solution where the left-hand side is not a permutation of the right-hand side? So maybe the xi's are not equal to the yj for all I and j. Okay, good question. The answer is yes in some cases. Here we are, here's an example. Didn't take very long to find this, did it? Well, if you think about searching for this, it won't take you very long, but if you had to search all the variables up to size 11 or so, you have to be slightly smart to get this to work in a modest amount of computer time. So already that's not so trivial. Okay, that's degree three, right? So that's good. What should we expect? How hard should it be to find a solution in this problem? Well, let's just think about this in rough heuristic, you can see hand-wavy terms, right? So. If I look in a big box of size x, I've got roughly x to the 2k plus 2 choices for all of the variables, haven't I? Because I've got 2k plus 2 variables. And what I'm asking for is that if I take the left-hand side and subtract the right-hand side, that should accidentally hit 0 for all of these equations. So I should hit 0 with a polynomial which, when I evaluate it, has size x, and another time when the typical size of a monomial is x squared, and so on. So somehow there's a constraint of size capital X to the j for each equation of degree j from 1 up to k. So if I sort of wave my hands vigorously, I might imagine that there should be roughly x to the 2k plus 2 divided by x to the half k plus 1 solutions altogether. I have rewritten that as x to the k plus 1 over 2 to the power 4 minus k to emphasize that when k is bigger than 4, I'm expecting the number of solutions to go to 0 as x gets bigger, which is disappointing. Well, there are actually diagonal solutions there, so there's something wrong with this heuristic, but at least it suggests that maybe it's very hard to find solutions when k equals 5 or more. And maybe even for k equals 4, it's tricky. What happens? I can tell you what is known. So here's a solution for k equals 4. Well, that was kind of the critical case, wasn't it? We thought maybe things could be good for us there, but for k equals 5, that should be hard. Okay, that's for k equals 5. That's just one of many solutions, actually. So the slide is getting too small to contain this, so we need new notation. So there we are. I'm going to rewrite this as the string of relevant integers with a subscript telling me what the maximum degree of the system is. Okay, so I could leave you to do the experiment and report back at the end of the lecture, but anyway, you can carry on with this. So there are solutions with degree 9, even 11. So this has 12 variables on each side. But that's the end of the story as far as we know. There are no known solutions for degree 10 or degree 12 or more. So yes, go find solutions. So I talked with Peter Bourgain about this, and he was of the opinion that, since you've got solutions all the way up to 11, sure, probably you've got solutions forever. Very optimistic. I'm of the opposite opinion. I think there are very specific accidents which occur which make it possible for these solutions to exist.
Trevor, are you looking for non-negative integer solutions?
Well, good question. Okay, so we could have audience interaction here. Who thinks that there's a distinction between negative and non-negative? Oh, let's have a referendum. Let's have a referendum. Who thinks? Okay, I'm not going to do that. When I do this in my classes that I teach, I have to modify the question. Who thinks just maybe, possibly, there's a... Yeah, okay. And I have to pay them money as well. So, okay, so if you had a solution with negative entries, this is translation dilation invariant, isn't it? So I could just shift all of the entries so that all of them are positive. Yeah, so I've got a cunning plan there. And actually, in this case, if you unshifted them, you will see that these integer solutions come in positive and negative pairs. And so that's one particular accident which occurs for some of these systems. So it kills all the odd degree equations instantly. Yeah, cutting. Yeah. But OK, so this is something which one can really play around with computationally and beyond. So I don't have an answer. It's all open. So what are we going to do? I'm going to modify this a bit to connect back up with the main theme of the talk, which I see I should accelerate smoothly into superluminal speed eventually. Yeah. So what I want to do is to increase the number of variables to make it easier to find a solution. And, so if I start thinking about the corresponding equation of degree k plus 1, one more than before. If I were to have n equal to k plus 1, I've got equal sums of powers 1 up to k plus 1. So if you think about Newton's formulae on roots of polynomials, you'll see that the xi's would just be a permutation of the yi's. So by inserting this condition, I'm sort of ruling out, when n is k plus 1 at least, that you have this just the trivial solutions. And this actually has some wider applications. So if you construct a polynomial whose roots are the x sub i's and another polynomial whose roots are the y sub i's, then when you look at the difference between these polynomials, you can see, again by Newton's formula on roots of polynomials, that all the coefficients of t to the m minus 1 match up. That's just the linear equation between the xi's and yi's. And the coefficient of t to the m minus 2 is quadratic, so that also matches up, and so on. So lots of the terms vanish, and you're left with a polynomial which has relatively small degree. But in particular, this coefficient is non-zero. So fx and fy are two polynomials with integer roots having all their highest derivatives equal, and at least some non-equal derivatives. Okay, so people apply that kind of thing. But let's focus on the problem itself. So it's an easy consequence of this resolution of the main conjecture that if s is k times k plus 1 over 2, then you definitely have solutions of this system of equations. And if you think about what this means, so we're asking that the first k equations are satisfied. So if we're looking in a box of size x, that's just counted by j s k of x, that's the number of solutions there. If the inequality were to fail, we have an equality. And so we're counting, we have a number of solutions counted by JS k plus 1. We've got the k plus 1 equation satisfied as well. So all we're asking is that JS k of x is larger than JS k plus 1 of x, and we know what these quantities are, at least up to x to the epsilons these days. So you can check that if s is bigger than k times k plus 1 over 2, we're set. So in fact, even the approximation to the main conjecture which was available before this past year would have gotten you this conclusion if k was big enough. And that's basically as much as we know how to do for that problem. I should mention, you can say a bit more in some sense. So if I want to have not just two sets of variables which satisfy this kind of property, but as many sets as I like, maybe h different sets where h is bigger than 2, then you get the same kind of conclusion with the same number of variables. So there's a bit of trickery to do that. Okay, good. So another easy application, which I should mention, is to Waring's problem. So now we're interested in representing a positive integer as a sum of s kth powers of positive integers. This is a classical problem that was studied by Waring, going back to 1770. And the particular aspect which is relevant in this context is the asymptotic formula for the number of representations. So we have a conjecture for what the number of solutions should be. It involves a quotient of classical gamma functions and a product of local densities, p-adic densities. So you should imagine that if you have solutions of a corresponding congruences to every modulus q, then this object is positive. It's basically true. And then it grows like n to the s over k minus 1. That's the conjecture. And it's been proved in many cases. And the interest for us is how big does s have to be for this to be proved? And I have a bit of notation for that. Just think of g tilde of k. That's the smallest number of variables you need to guarantee that you get this asymptotic formula to hold. It is conjectured to be k plus 1. Certainly true. I offer 5 of our worthless UK pounds for that. Okay, good. I didn't say what this is. This is an exponential sum just over k powers, but there's a mean value which is critical in proving this kind of result, which you can bound if you have good information about this Vinogradov mean value theorem. And if you get the optimal estimate in Vinogradov's mean value theorem, as we now know for s at least k times k plus 1 over 2, then you get exactly the right kind of estimate here to get an asymptotic formula with 2s plus 1 variables. So that's what's exhibited here. Classically, the number of variables that you needed grew like k squared log k, or even a constant times k squared log k. So now, using the ideas which are available with all their refinements, the bounds that you get for this quantity is better than you got from any other route, Weyl differencing, Hoare's lemma, work of Vaughan and Heath Brown. So it gets improved if k is 4 or more. So, and for large k, you can get away with k squared minus k plus order square root of k variables. Good. Okay. And I wanted to be sure that I didn't run out of time before mentioning applications. So there we are. There's a whole bunch of applications. I might say some more about one or two of these if I have time. So there's a whole zoo of applications. So there's applications to discrete restriction theory, things in additive combinatorics, or some product theorem, for example, work on uncongruencing, solutions of congruences in short intervals, and so on. Okay, so good. You don't have to read that. You should just be impressed that the list was long. Okay, so I do want to say, try to give you an idea of what goes on in the method. As I said, the method, from the congruencing point of view, is all about congruences modulo powers of p. You could set this all up so that you're looking at short intervals, where the shortness becomes shorter as you iterate. And actually, that's what Vinogradov was doing back in the 1930s. So it's kind of the Bourgain, Demeter, Guth ideas sort of go back to what Vinogradov was doing 80 years ago now. Okay, so let me remind you, here's our exponential sum, which we're interested in, which is involved with defining this mean value. And I'm going to take this fairly fast-paced. So I want to emphasize, don't study the details. I want to give you a flavor for what's going on. So one thing I want to do is to understand what the order of growth of this object is. And how do you do that? Well, here's the way. I look at a lim sup of log of js k of x over log x. What that measures, without thinking about it too hard, is it tells me that beyond some point, the mean value at my favorite point is going to be pretty big. Lambda s is kind of giving me roughly the right exponent for the growth. And at the same time, I get roughly the same thing as an upper bound, up to an epsilon in the exponent. So it's just measuring how rapidly this mean value grows. Good, I repeated that there. And what I believe, if I choose S to be whatever is my suitable test value, I would like to believe that for large S at least, this exponent is actually equal to this expression here. And I'm going to play a game here to try and convince you that this might be true when S is as big as k squared or more. So this quantity lambda ought to be zero if the main conjecture holds for S at least k squared. So we'll try to prove that this quantity is at most zero for S at least k squared and see where that gets us. And okay, what are the elements that go into the proof? So we study what goes on in congruence classes, modulo powers of p. So that's a bit of notation to encode the corresponding exponential sum subject to that congruence restriction. And we look at these auxiliary mean values where 2k variables are in a fixed congruence class mod p to the a, and the rest are congruent to a different congruence class modulo p to the b. Think of b as being bigger than a. Good. Okay. So that's that mean value again. So remember, flavor, don't study the details too hard. We're just aiming for the flavor. So if we use the same kind of philosophy as we did before when we were getting a lower bound for Vinogradov's mean value theorem, you can guess what the correct upper bound should be. And it's easier to think about what goes on if I normalize the mean value by what we expect its value to be. It sort of keeps track of the bookkeeping automatically. That's that normalized object. And here's the general strategy. So it's the highbrow overview. So we start by postulating that the mean value is actually rather bigger than we expect it to be, bigger by this capital lambda. And then we infer that this auxiliary mean value with parameters 0 and 1 is also rather bigger than 1 in a similar way. Doesn't take much to do that, actually. And then the important part is we want to show that whenever we have a lower bound for an instance of this auxiliary mean value, then we can generate another instance of it where the congruence classes are to higher moduli than before, a primed instead of a and b primed instead of b, and the discrepancy has grown. So it's not so obvious just by an instantaneous flash here, but what I've postulated here is that we've got more than the expected number of solutions by a quantity here, which grows roughly by a factor s over k in an exponent in this second lower bound. So I'm showing that the overabundance of solutions in one mean value is blown up into a much bigger overabundance in a relative sense for a mean value corresponding to a smaller p-adic neighborhood in this case. If you were in the decoupling world, you'd be looking at a shorter interval or smaller scale. Okay, so, and then you want to iterate this whole process over and over again, so you concentrate that overabundance of solutions and force the overabundance to blow up to such an extent that it's simply untenable that there are so many solutions. You just can't cram so many into one place. Technical question, so I'm supposed to stop at 10-2, aren't I? Yes, good, okay. I said superluminal speed, right? So I can just give you the key idea. Let's get back to translation invariance. So this auxiliary mean value which we're studying is just this one here. If I interpret it in terms of biophorgonality, in terms of underlying equations, it's a mean value where some variables are in an arithmetic progression modulo p to the b. And by shifting by the ADA here, pulling out the factors p to the b, I can see that another set of variables are subject to a congruence condition, which is not just modulo p to the b, but modulo p to the b and 2b, all the way up to p to the kb. It's a much stronger set of congruence conditions, an efficient set of congruence conditions. And you can interpret this stronger set of conditions by counting their number and forcing all the variables to be congruent to each other in pairs, modulo this much higher power of p to the b, p to the kb instead of just p to the b. And that is what's responsible for developing this concentration. So I can just give you the flavor here. So there's some compensating factor we have to take care of. When you reintroduce this information, you've got this much stronger congruence condition on variables now. And you play some games with Holder's inequality just to manipulate this so that you get back, you get back equations which involve auxiliary mean values of the type we saw before, but with a much bigger parameters involved. And also, the other mean value, which comes from Holder's inequality, is sort of a scaled copy of the original mean value. It was all about congruences, eta mod p to the b. I can use translation-dilation invariance to relate that to the original mean value with the same lambda involved. And when you combine that all together, that's what gives exactly the kind of concentration argument which I alluded to. I've cheated in a couple of places. So there's a sort of an independence which you have to introduce into these systems of equations. And that sort of slightly weakens this, but not in a way which affects the ultimate argument. Okay, and we are definitely out of time. So I'm gonna stop there. And that's a throwback.